Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to today's CLC Urban Pioneer Lecture Series. My name is Hui Ling and I'm from the Center for Liveable Cities. The CLC is a knowledge center jointly set up by the MND and the Ministry of Environment and Water Resources in 2008. With the aim to distill, create and share knowledge on livable and sustainable cities, we have three main work areas, namely research, capability development and promotions. The lecture series provides a platform for urban thought leaders and experts to exchange knowledge with the wider public. Today's lecture is part of the CLC Urban Pioneer Lecture Series, where we bring personalities to share on Singapore's development experience over the last 40 to 50 years. Today, we are very honored to have Dr. Liu Thai Ker, Chairman of the CLC and Director at RSP Architects, Planners and Engineers. Dr. Liu's lecture will examine the story behind the development of Singapore public housing over the last 50 years and how applicable this model is in other cities. Dr. Liu will start off with a short presentation on the topic. This will be followed by a Q&A session with the audience, which will be moderated by Dr. Aileen Wong, Academic Advisor at SIM University. Let us invite Dr. Liu on stage. Dr. Liu, please.
Well, good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you for your strong support for this lecture. It pleases me and also makes me nervous. Anyway, I'll try my best. So I'm going to talk about lessons from the past, and because it's not fair for me to talk about current issue, which is kind of in the flux. And I think it's good for me. I'll try to paint the HDB story from a broader perspective, not just focusing on the flats or the pricing. I think the importance of HDB is much wider than that. In fact, just now in talking to Aileen Wong, we felt that what we need to do is to give you a collective memory of what HDB is all about, and that's what I attempted to do. So anyway, just to reintroduce myself, and also some of you wonder why I'm giving a talk, because I was the CEO of HDB. And also, see, the word urban pioneer was applied on me, so that makes me an urban pioneer, 69 to 92. But of course, fortunately, with my good health, I continue to get involved. So just give you what I did in HDB was to acquire land, resettle, plan, design, develop, manage 23 new towns, not fully completed. So that gave me a wide scope of experience about public housing. URA, I actually did the 91 concept plan and updated the planning code, consolidated the conservation effort. CLC, I hope all of you would know that it is an urban knowledge hub about the past experience in Singapore and also sharing experience internationally. And we, in a short 5 years, we have actually made ourselves extremely well known around the world. And of course, thanks to Deng Chai, I think he's put in a lot of effort to do so. But if you see the word World City Summit again next year, you know the CLC is behind it, together with URA. Or Lee Kuan Yew World City Award, CLC is behind it, together with URA. And also, we have a yearly mayors forum of mayors from around the world. Okay. Now, RSP, I think I owe it to my partners to say that it's quite big. 800 people in Singapore. Now, I want to talk to you about the following seven topics. I think I'm given 45 to 60 minutes, so I should be able to cover this quite comfortably. So these are the topics. looking at what HDB did do, what were the key policies, and talking a little bit more about planning and design, even though the role of HDB is much wider than physical environment, but physical environment is something that is almost like an expression of all the software ideas behind it, and then the measure of success. Okay, this is well known to everybody, but I feel that we still need to state the obvious. Says large population, small island, and the government is committed to providing housing for everyone in Singapore, and therefore we have no choice to go high density. With high density, it will be high rise. Okay, and also in the process of doing that, since the scale, in order to house everybody, the scale of the operation is very huge. So we create new towns, and in the process of doing, we wanted the new town to be highly self-sufficient, so the people who live in the new town can get their daily needs, mostly including jobs, mostly satisfied within the new town. So these are some of the core values of HDB. And because of that, after having thought through our needs, having thought through what is good for the Singaporean and for the city, we actually managed to go against the world trend, because in the 60s and 70s, the world trend was against high-rise housing, against. If you look at all the literature, the newspaper. But we knew that in order to have home ownership for all, we had to do this. And we had to think through the problem. And therefore, I think the first generation government did this. Thinking through, when you clear your ideas, you have the courage to go against the world trend. I want to emphasize this, that while we are a small country, and especially now we're actually more developed than in the past, let's be very clear about what we want and do what we consider necessary, and don't follow the fashionable trend. Because fashionable trends come and go, and they just come and disappear. For example, in the 80s, the fashionable design theory was the, I can't remember, it's so long ago. It disappears now. Neo-Cartesianism, not, anyway, so don't follow the trend. Just be sure what you want to do. That, to me, if there's a message I want to send to you, this is a message. Think through our needs, have the courage to do what we believe we should do, and don't follow trends. So this is just to prove that the population is very big. So we have, and therefore, you see, in a place where the population is small, there's plenty of land, the pressure for public housing is much less because the land value is lower. And because the density is low, so land value will be low, and therefore you don't have to go to high rise. And therefore, the land component in housing in those other areas will be smaller. Whereas in Singapore, the land component in the total cost of development is very high. People can't afford it. Therefore, government have to step in. And we are not unique. I would say all Asian cities will have these problems. And therefore, we are a pioneer. Of course, the pioneer before us is actually Hong Kong. We learned a lot from Hong Kong, but we have improved upon Hong Kong's experience. Now, this is to prove to you that you can have the high density and high livability. Vertical bar is density, horizontal bar is livability. In other words, if we plan carefully, we can have a cake and eat it. High density doesn't equal poor environment. And therefore, a current issue, if we have to push for larger population, higher density, the key as to whether we can get good environment or not depends on how carefully, how cleverly, how well we plan the future of Singapore. So high density and livability are compatible. So I want to say this. Okay, high-density, high-rise building is common among Asian cities, but Singapore experience shows that it's been proven to be viable. And when we move forward, we may have to go for even higher density, but as long as we do our job properly, we can make Singapore still a good place to live in. Now, track record. Okay, what I want to highlight to you is that in 32 years, under SIT, they built 27,000 units. And but actually in HDB, of course, even currently, in 1 year, you build more than 27,000 units. That means we are very clear about our goal. Then we find ways to deliver. Okay, once we are clear about our goal, we must find a way to do it and not look for excuses for not delivering. That's what happened under SIT. They said, well, we didn't have good contractors, so we cannot build more. Whereas when HDB took over in 1960, we actually built up capacity of our contractors to deliver. So by now it's over 1 million units. So this is what we have delivered. And I'm using the 2012 information. I haven't been able to get the most up-to-date information. So what is important here in this slide is to show that HDB doesn't build apartments alone. HDB builds shops and factories. Okay. Actually, a whole lot of other things, but I just want to highlight that part of a success story of HDB is that we built shops and factories as well as a whole lot of other things to facilitate resettlement and also to get a profit from the shops and factories to cross-subsidize housing. And we clear basically all of the squatters by 1985. So this is just proof to say that HDB has built a lot. Okay, I don't think I want to go into the detail, just to show that a lot of floor areas have been put in. Now, the next thing I want to talk to you is that, in my view, HDB is not just one continuous story. In my view, there are at least six stages. And the stages are influenced by the steepness of the curve. In the beginning, initiation, we were just trying our best to make things work, build up our resources. Then second stage, after building our resources, we consolidated our ideas so that we kind of fill in all the missing gaps. And after having done that and standing on sure ground, then we started talking about refinement. So to be quite honest, that the flats built before the in the first and second stages, quality wasn't as good as we wished to see. Use of material was cheaper materials. But in stage three, we actually changed the use of material much better. And of course, after that, with the rising income of Singapore, we'll look for excellence. Excellence doesn't mean excellent appearance. It's excellence in every way, including the provision of amenities in the new towns. Now, and of course, by that time, we basically solved the housing shortage problem. So we had energy to look at the fact that whether the HDB resident flats or apartments could be an asset to the people. And that seems to be totally logical. That's, of course, the government's decision. Because why should private sector owns their properties and see appreciation in their property and not HDB? And therefore, we went through a whole lot of upgrading of older flats and therefore create. In fact, the HDB resident had a very good deal. For example, in a particular case, let's give you an example. The government would give about, say, 30,000 in those days for upgrading. The resident have to match with 10,000, so it's 40,000. After renovation, the property value went up by 70,000. So this is the kind of exercise government did to help people feel that they are owning and appreciating asset. And of course, after that, I left HDB, and I think there are all other kind of thinking about the role of HDB. But I'm saying that the first few, up to 1990, that was the story. So now here you see a whole lot of this upgrading program, the whole lot of this. I will not explain this because I can't even do a good job of it. But anyway, these are the various programs who help the older flats to upgrade themselves. Actually, every upgrade we bring subsidy to the owners. We bring huge asset appreciation to the owners. Okay, now let's just take you through stages. Stage one and two. Okay, initiation. We move from rental houses, flats to ownership, and the focus was shelter. And in those days, what was improvement? Cross ventilation, good plumbing, electric light, and so on. That's where we started. Okay, then after that, we'll actually implement the home ownership with the use of CPF. And we improve our delivery capacity so that we could build much more, because the need for resettlement and for housing the Singaporeans is very, very huge. You'll see later. And also immediately started sociological research. You can imagine in 1970, I was in my 30s, and I was really very concerned that whatever decisions I helped HDB make, if it was wrong, it would affect wrongly millions of people in Singapore. So I was nervous. So what I did was, on the one hand, I did a lot of interviews with businessmen, with government officials, and so on, to find out what made a good new town. At the same time, we engaged sociologists, almost a dozen of them, with PhD degree in HDB, to do research, do investigation, and give our architects and engineers and planners good feedback as to what makes a good city. And also, today, my main regret is that I underplayed the role of the real estate officers. Those of you who are my former colleagues, please forgive me. I just want to emphasize that the fact that we could continue to improve ourselves and get feedback, one very vital source was the estate officers. They were on the ground, everywhere, all the time, to find out what we did wrong, and find out what new needs people wanted, and fed back to the architects and engineers. And so this became a kind of virtuous circle. And I really feel that although we don't have such a thing as estate officers now in HDB, I think there's probably, if there is, it's a tiny, tiny part of it. But it used to be a big contributor to the improvement of HDB estates. So, what did we do? That's where we started. That was where we started. Okay. And then stage three and four, as I said, refinement. And before that, the public housing was called low-cost housing. And people felt embarrassed about that. But actually, by the time we started improving the materials and have better design, among ourselves in HDB, we said, that's the wrong term. You know, we under-market ourselves. So we changed it to public housing rather than low-cost housing, with larger flats, much more amenities, and much bigger building programs. And of course, by then, all the squatters disappeared. Well, if you want to challenge me, yes, there were about 0.04% of squatters still there. Okay. Okay, then we move into better design, better finishes, employing more, because by then we could afford to use technology, pay for technology. But actually, I want to say that on a number of occasions, I wanted to use metal fins and things like that, I could not afford it. So I had to keep using concrete. So this is how poor we were in those days. Okay, this is stage three and four. Okay, there was a big expansion because we consolidated, we built up our capability. Then stage five and six, okay, upgrade old estates, remove the HDB stigma. Reduce, because people used to, when I used to ask people, where do you live? Oh, somewhere in Singapore. I know that means HDB estate. You don't do it anymore. And we removed this stigma further by bringing private housing into the new towns. In fact, when I first tried to introduce private housing in the new town, I was totally nervous that they would not come because there was such a big stigma. Anyway, the first sale of site, the response was fantastic. So I asked my estate officers, I said, what happened? Why are they so keen to come? I said, well, with all the facilities we provide, why wouldn't they come? So there is a drawing power of private housing. And then, of course, now we're talking about my place, my home. Okay. Now, so stages five and six. Don't worry if it appears as if we use up all the new towns, because not all the new towns are fully developed. There's still plenty of land, okay? But I think we need to create more new towns for the long-term future. And so what I want to convey is that over the decades, HDB was ambitious. I think when I say HDB, don't forget I include our government. Without the government support, HDB doesn't mean a thing. Okay. With the support of government, HDB was ambitious but realistic. I think the two combinations is important. We did keep pace with change, as you saw the changing faces. Move with time and with means, our capability. We have to be realistic about that. Change the policies and standards, and the ideas to create. I think I take the liberty to add one more word: quality, home ownership for all. It must, and I think we have achieved that. Okay, quality. Now let's go to some of the key policies again, just to refresh your memory. The government made it easy for not only HDB, for all government departments. We had Land Acquisition Act and the Resettlement Act and so on to actually, as I travel around the different parts of the world, including Asia, America, and so on, what the government has laid a foundation for us to acquire land, to resettle people with relative ease, is something that we must be very mindful of. Without those backing and the foundation, HDB could not have done what we did in the last 50 years. So with those, we can implement our plan effectively. And this one seems to be a simple thing. You must know what your target groups are. Yes, we knew it, and we keep kind of expanding this gradually as we were ready. But most other cities, government, have their target groups. But that's only on paper. When it comes to implementation, for example, comes to allocation of flats, the target group seems to be shifted. Whereas we stick to a target group, and that's how the government maintain and earn the credibility of the support of Singaporean, and that's very important. Credibility is very important. And of course, it is subsidized, but we have to be careful that on the one hand, it's subsidized. On the one hand, whatever we deliver to the people must be value for money. And in other words, and therefore we actually, you should cut out all the frill, just give them the solid things. In fact, at that point we were thinking that what we need is to give them the biggest possible area that the budget would allow, so that we give the residents the freedom to decorate the whole flat, because the HDB flat is so highly standardized. How do you differentiate one flat from the other? Is to leave the decoration to the residents. And I think that policy seems to turn out very well, because every flat I went to looked different. But the only area that we did not allow too much freedom was the kitchen and the toilets. We put the tiles in, because if they start hacking out the tiles, there will leakage all over the place. So we didn't allow the tiles to be hacked out. Okay, so these are just kind of solid talk of experience. And of course, we have the various functions so this one is, the HDB is an organization that gives a kind of one-stop service, so that it's easy for residents to come to just one organization or one area office to deal with everything that he needs. Now, of course, it's a little bit diverted. For example, town council is different from HDB. And also very creative financial scheme, which everybody knows, except that we take it for granted to say, well, so what? You know, use of CPF and so on. But this is the envy of every other city I come to. It is such a brilliant idea that we just didn't realize that we are so fortunate to have such a brilliant idea. Okay. Now, what I want to say is that what are the clear target group? Most of you wouldn't even know. I think I'm old enough to know. And that is, we started public housing by building for the lowest group for rental who could afford to pay rent. Because if we started with the lowest group for rental who could not afford to pay rent, HDB would have gone bankrupt a long time ago. So we cannot be soft-hearted. We must make sure that whatever policy will come in must be sustainable. So we started with the poorest for rental who could afford to pay rent. And that's how HDB finance continued to be able to be sustained. Then later we move into higher group, and of course at the same time moving into the lower group still. But by then those lower group would have employment, because in the early days unemployment was a big issue. And when they had employment, of course it could pay rent. If they could not find employment, then quite a number of times, the HDB area officers gave them employment to be a cleaner, garbage collectors, and so on, gardeners, to make sure to help them pay for the rent. This is some of the job that HDB used to do in early days. And of course, we're very strict on the eligibility criteria. I actually realized that we should include singles as well. I mean, not just today, in the past. I cannot think of everything, cannot remember everything. It's a good thing that I'm talking to you today. In another 5 years, I cannot even put this PPT together. This is a reminder to Deng Cai. Okay. So anyway, what is important is that we kept our rules very simple. We work on keeping our rules very simple, so that it's easy for residents or the Singaporeans to know how to apply, and at the same time easy for them to use the place. For example, you know, we take it for granted that in HDB we don't have rules about number of persons per apartment. We don't have rules. We don't have a rules about how many people per room. But many other or most other cities, in the interest of maintaining quality environment, stipulate the number of persons per apartment, the number of persons per room. We didn't do that. Because you just buy whatever you can afford. Our priority is to house everybody, make sure there's no homeless. So kept the rule very simple. So here, the important thing is, must know what are your core mission, what are important to the people. And don't create unnecessary rules to make life complicated. And so, of course, we tailored the apartment sizes to affordability. And this was a constant exercise to look at the rising income, to look at the affordability, and use the money as much as possible to floor areas. Because you think about this, in a house, you can extend the floor area if you run out of space. In apartment, you can't. And therefore, what is difficult to change is floor area. So we spend most of the money in the floor areas. And if you want to decorate, you want to improve your rooms, when you have more money, you can do that. But when you have more money, you cannot increase the floor area. Okay. So that's a kind of priority in those days. And of course, this thing, just to refresh your memory, and also this is a 1998 price, okay? Not so long ago, 15 years ago, okay? And I got a little bit of update. There is an increase, and I think it's partly because of inflation and so on. But of course, this now has become an issue, and I'm not going to comment on it because I don't know much about it. I can only just look at the figure on face value, and this one also. But what I think is very good here is we do differentiate the HDB today, differentiate from non-mature versus mature estates. I think that's a good move. Now, and also, actually, when I was still in HDB, we again, with the help of sociologists and estates officers, I asked them to tell me what kind of rooms, the room size that we should focus on, or rather encourage people to buy, so that they, once they move in, they don't keep moving out. And because every time you move out, you know, I fear that you may create redundant housing. And if we end up demolishing them, it becomes a kind of a loss of asset. And the conclusion then was that four-room flat would actually be a best lifelong measure for most Singaporeans. And I think Singaporeans are intelligent enough that even though four-room flat came much, much after three-room flats, nowadays four-room flat is the most popular one. So that means a prediction of sociologists and estate officers and the reality coincide. That shows how good our sociologists are and estate officers are. Then, now, here is important. Very few cities have the setup of HDB. HDB did all of this. Of course, the function of resettlement is now gone. Land acquisition, if there's any, is totally minimum because the government actually acquired most of the land needed for public purposes. But, and of course, planning design is now partially outsourced. So the current HDB structure is different, but I think there's a good reason for doing that. But there's a loss, and that is the in-house expertise is weakened. And that, to me, is something that we should look out and find a way to improve. And you see, resident services is all important to the success story of HDB, because with resident services, we get enormous amount of feedback. And that helps us to keep improving our design, keep improving our new town planning. Now, creative financial scheme, everybody knows, but put it in a nutshell, it's very clever. Yeah, the government pays HDB in the form of loan only, not grant. Okay. Then HDB spend the money to build new flats and then sell and give the mortgage loan and sell the flats to residents. But residents has the opportunity to earn money in order to pay, plus the Central Provident Fund to pay HDB. But there's still a deficit there. That's where the government gives the grant. So this is a very clever idea. And the key to this, I think one of the key factors of success is CPF. Again, our CPF system is the envy of many, many countries. So nothing happened here is by chance. Everything that happens in Singapore is by design. And of course, HDB, don't forget, we have to pay back to the government. The accounting is very clear. Okay, but important thing is that we cannot just subsidize the residents blindly. The government must be financially viable. HDB must be financially viable. If we are kind of soft-hearted, we're kind of generous in the beginning, and then the government goes bankrupt, or HDB goes bankrupt, we will not be here today. So it must be affordable to both the people and also the government. How do we do that? Okay, we make profit. HDB makes profit from shops, factories, car parks. If you think they are good enough to run a shop and operate the factory, for heaven's sake, make profit and pay part of profit to HDB. If you are rich enough to buy a car, pay the full market price to HDB. That's a very simple logic. Okay. And of course, we get income from property tax and also corporate tax and personal income tax from the building industry. That's how we get the government get back the money to continue to give grants to HDB. So I think the strength of government policies, you know, I keep talking about HDB, but remember, it's a government behind HDB. Comprehensive chain of public housing policy, as you just saw, for all eligible citizens, as well as non-citizens. In fact, it should be all eligible candidates. You know? And also the large scale of our operation helps implementation, because the fact that the HDB scale is so large, we could afford to resettle people one community at a time. Okay, so that means these people who move to the new HDB estates, they are still with their old friends, they are still with their old relatives, and also we build the school nearby. That makes resettlement easier. So the fact that we could manage resettlement with not too much controversy, it was designed this way. Okay, I want to boast that I actually personally directed the resettlement of about 280,000 families. What did I do? Just 2-hour meeting every 2 months, that's all. Because everything is clearly designed. Okay. Now, I think a big part of HDB is the new town planning. So I want to emphasize that. Okay, the parameters, this is just a ballpark figure. And what I want to highlight here is that this density was subsequently reviewed when I was in URA to see whether for this kind of density, Singapore could accommodate the needs of all Singaporeans, all 5.5 million Singaporeans, by 2091. I was naive to think that the population will not reach 5.5 million until 2091. But on the other hand, if I did not plan for 2091, I planned for like 2013, we're in deep, deep trouble now. So it's a good thing that we plan long term. Anyways, so with this kind of density, we could accommodate every single person in Singapore for all their needs, you know, live, work, play, and so on. And this planning parameter is tied to the master plan. And also, you see, HDB to all of you is hardware. It's just blocks and blocks of flats. Okay, so what you see, so most of the time you criticize HDB for its architecture, but actually there's a lot more behind it. Okay, And actually, I would defend for HDB architecture, but I wouldn't. This is not the topic today, because the fact that we planned the city the way, the new town the way we did, we had the community spirit in mind. Apartment is the smallest community, just for the family. And the segmented corridor, in the beginning we have a long corridor, and corridor with one staircase, two units. And of course, when you have a staircase with two units per staircase, per floor, our estate officer told me that this is not going to work, because when you happen to quarrel with the family next door to you, you have no neighbors. As simple as that, okay? But despite that, despite the fact I knew that, one day we decided to do a survey among residents to say, well, which type of block organization you like best, the long corridor or the staircase with two neighbors? And before we launched the survey, I told my sociologist, I said, I know the answer already. I said, what? I said, those who live in a long corridor, vote for a long corridor. Those who live with a staircase with two units, vote for a staircase with two units. He said, how do you know? I said, people get used to what they have. They cannot imagine an alternative. And guess what? The survey result proved that I was right. So I'm saying this to say that while we have to listen carefully to the residents, and of course respectfully, but don't use that as a substitute for thinking through the problem ourselves. That's not a substitute, because most people really, they are not professional. They don't understand the big issues. They can only discuss based on their personal, very narrow experiences. So this is kind of survey of popular opinions. It's not a substitute for ourselves thinking through the problem. So actually, so we have this segmented corridor, and this also was done with the help of the sociologist, because I was told that a person can only have up to 7 neighbors. They cannot cope with more than that psychologically. So I give them 6 to 8 mainly. And this one, I want to tell you a story too. After we introduced a segmented corridor, I told my estate officer, I said, 6 months later, I want to visit the first block. So 6 months later, I went to visit the first block. I went to a Chinese family in the living room, and the children of all the neighbors went into the living room. There was a sense of community. So I said, maybe this fellow gave them too much sweet. I went to another one, happened to be a Malay family. Went inside, the children also went inside. So that proved that this segmented corridor is a smallest unit of a community. It works. So that's why, because I was conscious of the fact that if you cannot meet your neighbor until you go downstairs, now how many people would take the trouble to go downstairs? So this is one way to create a sense of belonging, a sense of community. But there is a bigger one. It's precinct. It's about 3 hectares or so. Because there was a survey to show that people can relate to a piece of land around 3 hectares. Bigger than that, he doesn't feel that he belongs to it. So this is another level. And there's a residence committee to handle that. And neighborhoods gives you the basic amenities. And then, why 50 hectares, by the way, is because that enables most of the people to walk to the neighborhood center in 350 meters. We did a survey. People in temperate climate were willing to walk up to 600 meters, but in Singapore, they were only willing to walk up to 350 meters because of the weather. So this number did not come just by agar-agar, no. Okay. And of course, a new town, why do we need this 40-50 dwelling? Again, it's a result of my study, interview a lot of people, and felt that for this new town to be a self-sufficient community, you need this population to support the shops, the emporium, the cinemas, the department stores, clinics, and so on. So by doing so, we can be sure that all these facilities that we want to attract inside that new town can survive. And of course, they have survived. In fact, there's one new town that really struggled to survive. Is Clementi, because the land given to me was too small. On top of that, there's an expressway cutting through it. So it's still struggling to have all the facilities. Okay, so that also, in a way, proves a point that you need the threshold population to support all the amenities and the facilities. Now here, I want to emphasize that probably not many of you realize that the amount of land given to residential is always less than 50%, because we need the rest of the land for roads or parks, etc., etc., etc. Okay, so that's how you have a self-sufficient community with all the amenities. In fact, a lot of foreigners come to Singapore. They were so envious of our HDB residents, even though HDB residents quite often are unhappy. They say, wow, you know, this is just what a good way to live. If you talk about livability, quality of life, this is one example of it. So we need this type of population to support essential facilities and amenities to make the new town highly self-sufficient. Now, I just want to show you a whole string of amenities and facilities which are, but please don't audit this because they're not in every new town, but just give you an example. This is the thinking. Commerce, okay, industry, we also, but these are non-political industry. Education, okay, whole range of that, okay. Okay, and then institution. You see, in fact, what I want to add is we did a study. We took 6 months to study the size, number, and location of petrol station. Yeah. Okay. And of course, as a multiracial society, we need, and also this. Now there's, and there are lots of reserve sites to cater for future needs in these areas. Okay. So these are the facilities. How do I know we need this? Because we got the feedback from the estate officers, from the residents, and so on. Okay. Including this. And it's no good to have a self-sufficient town if we don't have good transportation. Okay, although I put it last, but it's actually vital to the contribution of new town to the city. So I want to say that the comprehensive inventory of community facilities and amenities was really a big contribution from HDB to the city planning of Singapore. So if a city is like a machine for living, this facility amenities is a part of the machine parts. And I must say personally, as a planner, I benefited a lot in my 20 years in HDB to learn what are the machine parts, number one, how many of each part I need, and number three, how big is each part, because all these things become the ingredient to a master plan. And of course, after I went to URA and even now in RSP, I continue to identify machine parts to make the city even more complete. So you can see that although HDB stuck to our core mission, but we did expand. First of all, don't forget your core mission, but don't stick strictly to that. You should expand beyond the provision of shelter to include creating good homes, community building, as you saw earlier, good environment for convenience and comfort, and also contribute to the urban planning of Singapore. These were It's not an afterthought that I think about today. This was in our mind during the time. Okay, I also want to add on something about planning and design philosophy. So these are the roles of a new town. There are many. I just select a few. It should contribute to convenience, comfort, and to garden city. How do we tame the high-rise, that high-density monster? Many people come to Singapore and say, yes, your density is high, but I don't feel it. Now, this didn't happen by luck. It was designed not to feel it. Okay, let me just expand on this. Now, this is a new town. It's the anatomy of a new town. Expressway box, interchanges, MRT line, town center, arterial road linking to other towns, then neighborhoods, okay, and then with the greens, that's how we became one of the reasons we became Garden City. There's a green buffer, green ring around every new neighborhood, but also green footpaths, and also town center, neighborhood centers, and precincts, and a green ring around each precinct. So that you don't need to use up a lot of land, but you just remember to put green at every opportunity. Okay, and that, you know, you translate to land use is something like that. Now I want to show you this: how to make Singapore a garden city with limited green area. Okay, if you take the following shapes. Okay, circle, square, they're all 2 hectares, they're all. Okay, rectangle, thin rectangle, bits and pieces, they're all 2 hectares. Now, what kind of periphery do you get? 2 hectare circle, 500 meters. At the bottom, if you cut it up into small pieces, you get 1,780 meters. In other words, 3.7 times the periphery. That means if you have one big circle, you benefit only people of 500 meter periphery. If you cut it up, you benefit 1,800 meters of residents. So I'm not saying that we all must cut it up, but what I'm saying is that big is not automatically good. We have to have big and small as well. We need all of them, but don't underestimate the contribution of small green area given the same land area that we sacrifice. And that was part of the thinking. That's why we have the Bishan Regional Park, because it's a longish one. It benefits a lot of people. This is Bishan. Okay. Now, I want to talk about how do we tame the high-rise monster? Because this is a problem, and I'm talking about this particularly in current situation when everybody is worried about higher density and our environment will get poorly affected. But let's see, if we plan with methods intelligently, we can actually provide wonder. So the vertical line is the amount of effort you have to put in. Okay. So the green area, it's a government part. The black area, which I think is the right choice of color, is people. So anyway, the government must have vision, strategies, and preserve history and nature, protect history and nature, master plan, detailed plan, and so on and so forth. I want to highlight today that when we do master planning, at the same time, this is the word that I've never seen anyone else use, is to look at macro environmental design. Design the environment on a macro scale, which we did. And also, when we do the new town, we must look at the micro-environment design. In other words, it's not urban design, it's just shaping the whole area. Okay, and then urban design, this you are familiar with. I want to introduce a concept, micro-environment design, which was used. And the government must take the lion's share at the beginning, but leave the rest to the people. Now, a lot of people say this is undemocratic. Well, in fact, I was talking to some Americans last night, and they were so envious that our government could do this, because in their government, because of democracy, the government cannot take on such a big role, and then the future of the city is very uncertain. So while we get criticized by American-type Democrats, but I think we must be aware that this is the reason for Singapore to be the way it is today. The government involvement is very heavy. Because in my mind, the government's job is to create a perfect stage, and the people is to act out exciting drama on the stage. So we should give the people lots of freedom, but the government must also shoulder its responsibility. But why is the government still involved? Not because we still have censorship and all this thing. And of course, in a small place like Singapore, it's very important. Ethnic sensitivity, religious sensitivity is something that we must take good care of. And we have done so. And that's why we have a harmonious society. Of course, the government consists of professionals. And as a professional, I want to take credit for the role that we play. We did play a big role. And especially on the master planning and the new town planning side. But we did not do that all by ourselves. We actually educated our politicians. I think I didn't use the wrong word. Educate the right word. As professionals, we need to educate them, because they were not trained in this line. So the reason I want to show this, to highlight that the fact that our environment is so readable, people say that they don't easily get lost in Singapore, they almost know exactly where they are, anywhere they go, is because of the careful macro-environmental design and micro-environmental design. Obviously, urban design is important, but preceding urban design, we have two design stages that we don't often pay attention to. And also, don't forget, Singapore is a tiny place. A lot of people tell me that, we feel that our feeling is that Singapore is bigger than the real size. I said, yes, because I consciously created a sense of low density, a sense of bigness, and a sense of greenness. Now, this is the job of a planner. If we are honestly saying, okay, we have 700 square meters, so we make it look like 700 square kilometers, well, I think we're not doing our job well enough. It was consciously in my mind. You ask some of my old colleagues in HDB and URA, I said, we must create the illusion of bigness, illusion of low density, illusion of greenness. Otherwise, Singapore would not be as livable as you're enjoying today. So let's just focus on low density. How did we create it? It's using the chessboard. I don't play chess, but I borrowed the idea from them. I don't play chess because I'm too busy planning. Okay. So you have to use high and low zone carefully and put in, but the building spacing, I know it has subsequently been abolished, but I did spend a lot of time studying the building spacing in relation to heights to give a psychological well-being. Because you go to Taiwan, you go to China less so because they have the sun angle thing, but in Taiwan, some places are very congested. And you feel oppressed. Whereas in Singapore, I did spend a lot of time studying the psychological requirement of building spacing, so you don't feel oppressed. And also, we must keep our environment, because we're dealing with large buildings, high-density buildings, so the layout must be relatively formal. How do I help you understand this? You see, when you have a bunch of elephants, the only way you can get the elephant to maintain order is ask them to walk in line. If you start asking the elephant to dance, I think it will take total chaos. So big building, we must maintain certain amount of continuity, certain amount of tidiness. And also, the fact that precinct was introduced, it was my hope that we plan each precinct as one piece of artwork and not separate buildings. Okay, this is, you saw this earlier, it is a prototype HDB plan. Now how, this plan, you look at it, just a bunch of land use, but inside there is a high and low density concept. Okay. The black part, that will be housing, is high density, tall building. The color part is low density. So when you are in a new town like this, you never feel that everywhere you go is tall buildings, as you see in many other cities. That's how we manage to keep the high density environment in check and maintain good quality. And where's the inspiration? This is inspiration. Okay, now I want to talk about the contribution of HDB new towns to the city. To my mind, it's a basic urban building blocks. So that's like bricks are the basic urban building blocks to a building, plus the road system and MRT system. It contribute to minimize travel needs, and of course, together with a lower carbon footprint, reduced travel time, enhanced quality of life, and also create high-density corridor for MRT to work better. And also within HDB Newtown, we rationalize the road MRT bus transport system. It works like a machine. Recently, I took some Chinese TV crew to one of the new towns. I said, you see, here is the town center, the car park, the entrance to the MRT. I said, oh, this is an urban machine. I said, yes, you understand my point. Yeah, it works like a machine. Okay. So now we talk about the design philosophy. I think it is very important. I think we when we go to European cities or even New York, I think harmony and tidy streetscape attracts us. In fact, I often tell the Chinese city laymen, I said, the first Chinese city that achieves tidiness is unique, because every city wants uniqueness. I said, don't have to try very hard. Make your city the first city to be tidy. It's unique. When you come to Singapore, you like Singapore. Why? The big reason is because our cityscape is very unique, very tidy. So don't underestimate a mundane word, non-sexy word like tidiness. Okay. And of course, we have height control. Singapore, you probably didn't realize it. In certain area, suppose the average building height to achieve the plot ratio is 10 story. In some area, we limit the height to, say, 12 story. So that means you can range between 12 and 8. In certain area, for the same plot ratio, I said, okay, you can reach 16. So you can range between 16 and 4, and so on. So certain area, I want the building height variation to be less. Certain area, I want it to be bigger. That's all within the hand of a planner to decide, without sacrificing the plot ratio. So when you drive through Singapore, you see the environment being different from place to place. That was by design, not by accident, not by luck. And of course, even in HDB estates, we must maintain the building line to maintain a certain sense of street and not just allow the building to jump in and out, as you see in most other Asian cities. So, but at the same time, avoid building a wall. For example, you see this is Bishan. You take a look at this. All the buildings observe the building line. Okay. And therefore, when you look at, but of course, it's in two dimensions, they all look very dull. But in three dimensions, we vary the building heights. So it doesn't look very dull. So, but by doing so, you have interesting urban scape, but at the same time, having interesting skylines. Okay, the rest is more detail. I will not go into it, but I just want to say that building block design is to design a community. Okay, it's not just hardware. There's concept of community inside the building block. It's not just hardware. We create communities inside. Okay, we have block organizations, and I mentioned earlier, courtyard in the sky is what we finally evolved. Void deck, there was a time I suggested that one third safe for residents, one third for the aged, so that the aged parents can live downstairs with their children living upstairs, and then kindergartens as well. And this was not my decision, it was the result of discussion with the estate officer, with the sociologist. And also being worried that all the HDB blocks are high rise, so we introduced a scale indicator. That means single story void deck. It's a single story, but it's not in the void deck, it's an attachment. So that this single story building can be pitch roof, can be metal roof, so that it creates a human scale even in the middle of high rise. And you see some of this in some of the estates also. And for your sake, we did spend a few months studying crime prevention design. Basically, is to disallow blind corners. In the layout of the block, what you see is just simple layout, you know, with uninteresting design, but actually, even all these points were considered in the block design. Okay, this is just to... Even the flat design, we design as a way of life, okay? You have to think about optimum flat size and the circulation pipe pattern. How would it fit with furniture layout? And also, of course, we get the feedback from all these people. And you can, if you want to call me a dictator, I accept, because I didn't allow anyone to design a flat by himself. It must be collective, because we are not treating this as a design, an expression of personal flair. We're actually designing something for people to live, design a way of life. And of course, constantly upgrading. Okay, I think if I can talk about HDB architecture, yes, we actually think about this issue, expression, tropicality, and so on, in relation to climate and lifestyle. Okay, and also, like the block, we're not treating as hardware. It's a small community, okay. And we study building science to maximize cross ventilation, minimize the sense of stuffiness inside the flat. The sense of stuffiness inside the flat was studied and was remedied. Okay. And actually, I want to say that beauty doesn't come from expensive materials or from creative shapes. Beauty can come from something that costs nothing, is proportion. Just ask yourself, what's the difference between Miss Universe and the rest of the women? They have two eyes, two ears, one nose, one mouth. What's the difference? Proportion. So if you handle the proportion nicely, you get every block of HDB flats Miss Universe. So the fact that high density cannot be create good environment, that's a false assumption. The fact that low cost cannot create beauty is a false assumption. We just have to use our cunning to find out what's the best design. Okay. And we must design our building intelligently based on scientific facts. So a building can be handsome even at a low cost. Now, just to give you an impression of the progression, okay, in the 50s, 1.3 million people live here. Okay, they didn't solve the housing problem, but I think the designs are rather nice, but not tropicalized. And then Queenstown, Topayo, Amokyo, you can see that there's a greater sense of order, greater sense of just position of green and the buildings. So you can feel that the gardens are nearer you. And of course, with the so-called the regional park in Bishan helps. Now, I think measures of success. First of all, we had to start the HDB. Resettlement was a big start the project. Resettlement, then we created new land. What do we do with the new land? One is for housing. One is for creating land for commercial industry and infrastructure. When we started in the 60s, if you look back at the old newspaper, almost every second day, the word survival appeared in the newspaper. Could we survive as a country with such a tiny piece of land? And therefore, and also we almost hardly had industries. And there was a kind of central area which wasn't a proper CBD. So resettlement actually helped to generate all these possibilities, which today we take for granted. But if you want to trace to the origin of the contributor to what you enjoy today, is HDB. We did a lot of resettlement. But of course, behind HDB was very good government policy and government support. So let's try to understand how we came to the way we are today without dismissing everything we have. And with that, of course, then on the one hand, HDB will contribute to urbanization. On the other hand, the combination of these last two blocks will create jobs, economic growth, and so on. This is in a very highly distilled way, the measures of success, and HDB play a big part. Resettlement is more than just clearing squatters. Okay. We actually always mix the resettlement people, almost like normal ratio is one-third resettlement, two-thirds from other places. So the children can live together, and the children of resettlement families learn how to become urban people. Now that was by design. Everything we did was designed. Okay, you can use a nasty word called social engineering, but social engineering for a good cause is still good. Okay, we clear land for commerce and so on, and remove pollution. Okay, now this was where we started, 1960. Wow. 1.3 million people live when we only had 1.9 million in Singapore. And this is where we are today. And also, HDB, in the process of doing resettlement, faced this problem. Okay, the kind of tractor parks, the funeral parlors, the car repair workshop, where do we put them? Now, when you next time go to Siming Estates, just thank HDB. Okay. And also, we used to joke among ourselves that our service was from cradle to grave. Okay, we provide nurseries and so on, but we also built the phase one of Mandai Columbarium to facilitate the resettlement of the graves. So I would say that while we stuck to our core mission, we also looked around to see that there are areas that no one government agency took care of. We step in and solve the problem. Now, another contribution of HDB is to upgrade building industry. As I said earlier, SIT said, well, we could not build more because the building industry was backward. It's true. So when HDB first started, we invited anybody who was willing to be a contractor, even with zero experience, we will get them in. But in doing so, we gradually upgraded them. Can you imagine that we even had to force them to buy a cement dump cart as part of a contract? They didn't even have that. Then later, we have asked them to buy the lift as part of a contract. And later, we asked them to buy a computer to chart the progress and so on. This was not done by luck. HDB forced them to do it and say, buy this, we're willing to pay this as part of a contract in order to upgrade the industry. So in other words, when you have a problem, you have to solve it. And that's the spirit of HDB. Construction technique, okay, precast, prefab, was introduced by HDB. In fact, I dare say today, or even by 1985, even by 1980, Singapore's prefabrication technique must have been the best in the world. It's probably still the best in the world, the most advanced technically. Okay. And Singapore's construction, the HDB contractors' safety record is the best in the world. Again, it used to be hopelessly bad. So we intervened and introduced certain practices on the construction site. And then now it's the best in the world. You probably don't know that, but I'm telling you, be proud of what we have. So HDB is not just about hardware, it's a lot of other things. And also, in the old days, whenever we started to ballot the flats, people would say, oh, who's your contractor, huh? Is he good or not? Or maybe I should not buy his... Okay, you don't ask this question anymore. You don't. You don't even know these questions were asked at every balloting, because HDB introduced workmanship quality control. In fact, we asked Shimizu to help us upgrade the quality control. And I asked Shimizu, I said, you help us do three contracts on one condition only. Condition is you are not allowed to talk to the contractor. You must talk to our engineers and architects so that our engineers and architects could record everything you tell them so that we have a handbook to guide the future architects and contractors. Anyway, after three contracts, we thanked Shimizu. Then Shimizu, 6 months later, said, well, we noticed that you actually did very good documentation. Can we have a copy? So my architect engineer said, this is our intellectual property. I said, give it to them. We should be thankful that they help us upgrade is upgrading productivity and workmanship. So Shimizu should have a copy somewhere lying around. And we introduced many new building products. I will not go into detail, it's too long. Okay. And also conduct building research. Of course, lift, this is important. Why is it that people now accept high-rise living? Because we really went to a lot of pain to get lift maintenance and lift design done in almost a nearly perfect way. Because in the past, Nobody wants to live go up to further than six floors. Then with the lift improvement, they happily go up to 12 floors. Then there's someone that says, well, I want to see further, 24 floors, no problem. Lift, it didn't come by accident. Okay, now, green design, because actually, if you design for good cross ventilation, with good orientation, it's the beginning of green design. This is just to show, to prove that there is research going on, okay? This is current research work. Again, I want to emphasize, good lift maintenance is good high-rise building and high-rise housing. Now, just to test your memory, can you remember these battle cries? Anybody remember this? It was in every HDB annual report up to the early 80s, breaking the backbone housing shortage because we're catching up to clear the squatters. Of course, around the mid-60s, home ownership for all. Okay, now we take it for granted, probably don't even know such a word made a difference to housing. And just now you saw that from low-cost housing to public housing, just to remove the stigma of HDB. And I want to add that it is impossible for Singaporeans to be homeless. Impossible. I can tell you stories about that. Social benefit. Okay, home ownership is very important. It gives political stability. And in the process of doing that, we do the population distribution in terms of density, in terms of ethnic distribution. And also, we built in community development in the hardware. And of course, make provision for the parents and children to live nearby. Now you think about this, not many places go into such detail to make your life livable. So these are the achievements. I read somewhere that in US, which is the richest country in the world, only less than 50% of people own their own homes. But in HDB, 95% of people are satisfied with what we did. Now, these four words, no homeless, no squatters, no poverty ghettos, no ethnic enclaves. Just think, how many cities outside Singapore can claim this? So again, I have to clarify, I'm not a member of PAP, okay? But I think Singaporeans must know what we have and be happy. In other words, be less unhappy. I cannot think of any city that can claim these four simple statements. This is satisfaction level. So the fruit of the various research is we create communities at different levels, design building intelligently, that means it makes scientific sense, green building, and of course, beautiful cityscape. Contribute to this, I think HDB can claim that we have contributed to this. In fact, the first pre-stressed beam was done by HDB in Buena Vista swimming pool. The first. Okay. And the first step footing in Singapore was done by HDB also in Buena Vista estate. And a lot of contribution to construction industry and the art of estate management. Economic benefit. You can create employment near home and also economic growth. Okay, if you look at the graphs, actually the gray area is a secondary industry. We actually rose very, very fast in our tertiary industry. But if you look at it more closely, because many people say that HDB construction contributed to economic growth. If you look at this, yes, in the early days, if you look at up to, say, year 2000, whenever there was an economic crisis, we step up the HDB construction, because then you create employment, you create the flow of cash. But now, this role is not so important because of the rise in tertiary industry. But HDB did contribute. Yeah. Closing remark, I want to say that, just recap, these are the mission. It was not just shelter. It's about clearance, about housing the nation, about ownership. And HDB did so many things because, given the big organization, I think it's HDB's duty to explore, research, solve problems. And also, I think HDB could do all this because we had in-house expertise. Critical success factors. Government is all important. Okay, government support is all important. CPF and state land ownership, which we take for granted in Singapore, is like a rare gem in other cities. And we're so lucky that we designed this to make everything work so easily. And target setting must be credible, uncompromised, not abused, which we did. So, and also, the HDB as an organization was an integrated organization, did everything, so it's a one-stop service. And also, the good policies create a virtuous circle. And I think we must give a pat to professionals. We did a good job. Okay, is the experience transferable? Okay, I always tell foreigners, I said HDB experience is an open secret of our successful urbanization. Open because everybody can see. Secret because nobody understands how it happened. So today I'm unveiling the secret. But there are still secrets behind the secrets, so you still have to pay me to find out what are the other secrets. But at least you know there are secrets. At least that's a good starting point. Why is it open? Because everybody can see. Why is it secret? Because nobody bothered to know why and how. And actually, once you know the secret, the same planning principles and planning methodology can be used everywhere. If you know, just how to adapt it. I think the success of HDB track record owes also, not in small part, to the corporate culture. Okay, we interpret the HDB core mission more broadly, not narrowly. We develop a power of anticipation. Before problems surface, we already know. Good example is that we're able to detect the failure of every lift every 2 or 5 seconds, I can't remember, before the residents even knew about it. That's just one small example of power of anticipation. And also filling the gaps that other departments or ministries don't do, so that there's kind of all-round benefit to Singaporeans. From greater grave service, and so again, I want to emphasize, clarity equal courage. How did HDB dare to do this? Because we thought through, we think through every issue before we embarked on them. So this talk, finally, to inform what was done and also to hope that the HDB residents, after hearing this talk, will enjoy their homes more and less big, less grumpy. And Singaporeans, hopefully we understand that HDB is not just for people eligible for public housing. It has contribution in a much wider way than you think. And also, hopefully, the other cities will now know the secret of our HDB experience, but only partially, I must add. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Liu, for sharing some of the secrets of Singapore's public housing with us. May I now invite Dr. Aileen Wong to join Dr. Liu on stage, please. Ladies and gentlemen, due to the overwhelming response and attendance at this lecture, we actually have with us a full audience here at this auditorium as well as at the function hall next door. So we have catered for a two-way live feed for the Q&A session. We will first be taking questions from the auditorium, followed by questions from the function hall. Friends at the function hall, would appreciate it if you could prepare your questions early. We will be taking three questions from each venue due to time. Lastly, please state your name and organization before you launch into your questions or make any comments. Thank you. I'll hand the time over to Dr. Aileen and Dr. Liu, please.
First of all, I must thank Dr. Liu for giving us such a comprehensive overall picture of the success story of public housing in Singapore. In fact, after listening to him, I'd like to suggest that he should have modified the title of his talk, The Great Singapore Success Story. But anyway, jokes aside, I think it is very valuable that we try to preserve institutional memory, take a look at our past, what we did, and I'm also equally sort of concerned that many young people nowadays actually do not really know. You know, they don't think back even into 30 years, 40 years, how we began, how we got here. And a couple of years ago, I tried to do something to describe the HDB public housing story at my university, SIM University. There were students, there were staff members. All of them, nearly all of them, live in HDB estates, housing, right? But actually, after my talk, they came up to me and said, we never knew HDB did so much. And in so many different ways, you provided for us, for our sort of living environment and also catering to our lifestyle. So I think this is a story that we should appreciate. Now, I had some questions and I listened to Dr. Liu along, but he actually answered them already. Like, for example, he said HDB residents can be unhappy about HDB living, but actually the social studies that show every survey we did was a high level of satisfaction. So what you hear recently, happened recently, it doesn't necessarily describe, you know, what might be for the long term, but it doesn't mean that we should not face and you know, look at how we resolve future challenges. With that, may I invite questions from you all? Please be brief, and as the MC said, please identify yourself and just ask a question. Well, you can say a few things, but not a speech, please.
This is Lim Sui King. May I be sure that actually you are telling us a monopoly with full responsibilities from design planning to town council can be actually efficient and can be stable and provide a nation a stable policy. Because now today, town council seems to be a political instrument. So may I confirm that actually monopoly can be efficient?
I'm not. So I don't think I'm qualified to discuss the pros and cons of monopoly. But a short answer to you is that there is a bit of check and balance in the sense that if HDB, with all the power that it was given, did a bad job, the voters would do something about it. So there is a check and balance there, and it was important for HDB to do a good job. The current town council, I'm not saying that it's bad. In fact, there was a reason for town council, is to pass the decision-making of the estate management back to the people. But I think we could have that advantage, plus maybe a stronger feedback link from the town council to HDB. That may, then we can have a cake and eat it.
Second question. Yes, please. Professor Su Guanyin.
Hi, Thai Ker. Su Guanyin from NTU. I know you are in great demand by the Chinese in terms of planning their cities, in terms of solving their problems and so on. I know it's a very different country, it's a very large country and so on. And they don't always listen to you, all your advice. What would you suggest to the new team of Chinese leaders in terms of solving their property problems?
Actually, they have asked me, and I may be just starting to advise one of our cities. One problem, technically or professionally, is that at the moment the Chinese government has many government housing schemes, maybe five or six of them, and each of them is administered by a separate agency, and therefore they don't have the, because you notice in my talk today that we were not just solving housing supply issue, we are creating communities. So when you have different agency doing its own thing, you do not create a community. And at the same time, the fact that I also mentioned that the fact that HDB operation is so big, it actually gives us the economy of scale, it gives us the flexibility of solving multiple problems. When you have separate agent policy, you can't do that. Let me just add one thing about economy of scale. When I was in HDB, I asked our contract officers to do a study to say that given the same site, the same design, if it's done by HDB, how much saving do we have compared with it's done by a private developer? Because of the economy scale, the fact that we could buy materials in bulk and so on. And the answer was about 30%. In other words, even without subsidies, any one of you who lives in HDB flat, you already have a head start of saving 30% of construction costs. And that's so I think the Chinese kind of band together their policies. You can still keep all your policies, but when it comes to city level, let one agency handle that. Of course, politically it's complicated, but this may be a way to solve the problem. And of course, the other one, frankly, in this room, is that can we solve the corruption problem, abuse of the privileges given to the people through the subsidized housing? If we cannot solve that, we cannot start any kind of public housing scheme in China.
Ambassador Chan Hing Chi, please.
Chan Hing Chi, the Lee Kuan Yew Center for Innovative Cities, Singapore University of Technology and Design. Thank you very much, Thai Ker, for the very comprehensive view of the history of HDB and what it did. I thought I had studied Singapore history, but you know, that was clearly a gap, you know, in my study. Now, the question I have for you is this. You have talked of design to inculcate or to engender, to encourage certain social behavior. You believe in the power of design and architecture to generate that behavior. My understanding as a social scientist of what is happening on the ground is that we still have these recurring problems in Singapore of residents who don't get on with each other. They don't resolve their quarrels very well. They bring the quarrels to the community, your town councils, or even the MPs. Simple quarrels of living and just the, you know, stories of, you know, whether you have a pet that does his business in front of somebody's doorstep. If you have a quarrel, you keep, you know, bringing the pet back to the same door to, you know, annoy your neighbor. I think that, you know, when I did my fieldwork as a research student, I would listen to some of these Meet the People sessions to see what people were bringing up. Then there were a lot of stories about how do you resolve a neighbor's problem, and you bring it to the MP. I'm sure Aileen has that experience. So the power of design in solving this is not so clear, and we do need something else. And what is that something else?
Well, Thai Ker asked me to answer this question, although we are not on a panel. You know, I'm just a moderator. But I happen to be one of the original sociologists he was talking about from the early 1980s. I worked with him, I worked under him on, you know, understanding human behavior, social community formation, and so on, with regard to how your physical environment is being planned. Now, I do believe that the physical environment does influence human behavior, but only to a certain extent. I mean, just like what Thai Ker said just now, he said he provides a stage. The people must be the actors. They have to act out, you know, the desires, the wishes, and so on, and even the personality quirks. Problems between neighbors is really quite insoluble. You ask any HDB estate officers, you ask the town councillors, you ask an MP, nobody can resolve problems between neighbors. But to a certain extent, I think HDB rules, simple rules about keeping pets, about noise and people coming to knock on your door and ask you to please have regard for your neighbor downstairs, upstairs, those things work. But I can quote you recently that in a study of social capital formation among HDB residents, there is some evidence, quite remarkable evidence, that the way we provide facilities, the way we plan the routes around the estates, okay, the way we do the blocked building by point design or common corridor and so on, does lead to social interaction. And more social interaction lead to a higher social capital. So it actually vindicates the planners' parameters. And I think, you know, these kind of studies are very valuable because they can be transferred to anything, you know, even to private housing estates and so on, perhaps to other countries and other cities. Yeah, that's my take on it as a sociologist.
Thank you, Aileen, because Aileen actually has made two stints in HDB. One is in the early 80s, most recently the chairman of HDB. As a designer, I feel that we should design something, a physical environment, as conducive to human interaction as possible and hope for the best, because the alternative of designing something not conducive will probably create more problems. It's a question of degree.
Perhaps it's time to allow the audience in the other room to raise their hands, please. Yes, I see one.
Thank you, Doctor. My name's John Algar from a London-based think tank called Bright Blue. A couple of days ago, Nobel Prize-winning economist Joseph Stiglitz wrote an opinion piece for the New York Times titled Singapore's Lessons for an Unequal US. In it, he specifically praises the 93% level of quality home ownership that Singapore have achieved, and as you said, versus only about 50% in the US, as a comparative example of what he terms the Singapore government's commitment to social and economic equity. In your remarks, you noted that many emerging Asian cities have and will continue to learn from Singapore's public housing experience. But in his article, Stiglitz didn't detail any of those open and secret housing policies that are transferable from Singapore to the US. So my question is, through your conversations with American federal and state government officials, what do you think the key retrospective lessons are that US cities can learn from Singapore's public housing experience to improve levels of economic and social equity within the constraints that you outlined that US government faces of the democratic mandate. Thank you.
This is the answer Hang Chi should answer. Anyway, I have a crack first. Maybe you can add something. Now, actually, it so happened last night I was with quite a few people from USA, New York included, and they were really envious of the way we did things here. And they felt that democracy was very often a stumbling block to implementing the development that we have. I think that's certainly an issue. But if we take an optimistic view, I think clear government policies as to what the society needs is a good starting point. And second is to find the right methods, creating the right agencies to implement this kind of policies. And maybe the policy should not be single dimension, but multi-dimensional. In other words, if you pick one measure that solves many related problems, so the multiplier effect would be much greater. So I think this is a Singapore story. But fortunately, in Singapore, the government also paved the ground, as I mentioned earlier, on Land Acquisition Act, on the Resettlement Act, and so on, to make things more easier to implement. And this is something probably rather difficult in USA, but personally I feel that good ideas often can overcome, at least to a certain extent, the obstacles. Once I was talking to one of my bosses, I said, well, I need this road to cut through this area. I said, but just let me draw it, and I guarantee you I don't need this road for another 20 years. So at that time, things would resolve themselves. So I drew the road onto the map, and then a few weeks later, I said, well, about that road that you just drew, when can we start implementing? In other words, when you draw something or you paint a solution in a very doable way, it becomes a reality. I think that's probably one of the ways that we can overcome some of the political problems faced. No, in USA, of course, this two-party system that makes it difficult. In China, they have other kinds of problems. And why do I keep going back to China to help them? Because I feel that as long as they see a good idea, they are less likely to implement bad ideas. And that's my hope.
Anyone from the other room, please? Second question.
Hi, yes. It's very heartening to hear of the amount of research undertaken in various aspects of HDB design. I was wondering if Mr. Liu could speak of how the 99-year leasehold structure was arrived at, and also whether there was a research undertaken into pricing level of HDB flats at the outset and towards the end of his time at the helm of HDB. The second part of my question relates to his comment on the 30% cost implications arising from the economies of scale that HDB enjoys. How does that compare to the, how does that impact the construction cost of HDB? Thanks. At an absolute level.
Thank you.
Well, the second question basically is that I explained that through the economy of scale, through our ability in those days when the construction volume was very big, of bulk purchase of materials, and through another very important point, our timely payment to contractors of the progress payment. Timely. In fact, the instruction to me then was that whenever the contractor gave you a valid progress payment after checking, pay them within 2 weeks. So when you pay them within 2 weeks, the contractor did not have to build in financing costs, and therefore the construction cost goes down. So all these things actually help to keep our costs lower by about 30% from the market costs. The first question is about research. Right? Current research in HDB, probably Kun Hien can explain, but I know that there's still a lot of active research on prefabrication, building science, and so on, or even green building research. And I think we should be very grateful that the spirit of research in HDB still carries on.
Is there? Yes, I saw an hand there. Yes.
Good afternoon, Dr. Liu and Dr. Wong. I'm John, just an architect. I'm going to be very short, but I make three observations. I'd like to get some responses from Dr. Liu. First observation, my simple mind tells me the way the public housing was designed and planned, it was way ahead of this new trend called sustainability. Yeah? Second comment is that our community development in Singapore is probably one of the most significant architectural and planning projects in the world. I have not seen anything of that scale and that success in the world. And so I'd like to make a simple suggestion that we may want to change the name HDB to Community Development Agency or Board rather than Housing Development. Because I know the brief given to you by the politician was housing shortage. But I think in the way the agency has redefined the problem and expanded the solution to become a community development project. Now the third comment is, I think there's another even a creative idea of a higher order magnitude than the CPF scheme in our public housing. And that is what I call social transfer. So I don't think I've seen it anywhere at all, except Singapore. So maybe Dr. Liu can give some elaboration on this thing called social transfer. Thank you.
Excuse me, we could not catch the last question. Can you please repeat? Social what?
Actually, to me, the design brief was public housing, right? To house everybody. But I think the agency has redefined it into, maybe the broader policy or the broader perspective behind the public housing is actually social transfer. Social. Yeah, a lot of social transfer is done through this public housing agency.
Did you say called social conscience?
That's the even more subconscious part of it. But what we see in the ground is actually social transfer. In other words, actually a lot of the wealth from the private housing and the other foreign direct investment is actually the feed from the government through the grant of land into the HDB. So through that process, there's a lot of social transfer done by the government, which a lot of people may not see, you see. Thank you.
Can I answer that? If I could just address your point a bit. The government does do a lot of social transfer through the HDB because we do have, more than 80% of the population living in HDB flats. So if we were talking about social assistance to the lower income groups, those who live in rental flats and so on, the government does, and through the town council gives rebates, on conservancy charges and so on and so forth, So this is just an instrument, in the hands of the government to effect social transfer. Now, HDB by itself does not have this as a mission, okay? The reason why would you suggest that HDB should be known as the Community Development Agency. Are you suggesting the new Ministry of Community Development should henceforth not be there?
Dr. Lee, would you like to
No, the first, his 2 points are comments, I believe. They are not questions. Thank you. Now, may I ask this audience now, because time is running short, at the most we have 10 more minutes. If you have other questions, please. Yes?
Hi, my name is Chetan Dave. You talked about helping the Chinese. So there is another big country in this region, India, which has a huge housing shortage as well. The big impediment that they have been wrestling with in clearing squatters and creating housing, which is a big issue, is that most, unlike Singapore and China, the land ownership is in private hands. And property ownership in India is very similar to property ownership and rights in the United States. Do you think that the Singapore model is effective or is transferable in countries which are as democratic as the ones we are discussing and where the state ownership of land is crucial? Second question and a corollary to that, that Hernando de Soto, an economist who talks about removal of poverty, has in fact said that squatters should be given property rights. So therefore they can borrow against their squatters and improve their lives, which is very different from removing squatters, taking their land and putting them in public housing. So there are two diametrically opposite views of how to go about housing squatters in urban environments. Can you talk to that?
Okay. Certainly in the case of Singapore, state land ownership is very important, but also our master plan and the development guide plan enjoy an authority that I don't see elsewhere. Even a city as similar as Singapore, like Hong Kong, their master plan doesn't have the teeth that we have in Singapore. So when you have a master plan that have the teeth to say, well, if you want to develop, you follow this plan, it makes a huge difference. So these two factors are commonly not available in other places. So because if land ownership is in private hands, but if the master plan is well created and has an authority to tell the landowner how to develop, there could still be some hope. But in many cities, even this doesn't exist. But I personally feel that, certainly as a planner, we must be an incurable optimist, because if we don't, then we must sure not do anything. So I always believe that a good planning idea, a good plan, can at least swing over certain support. Maybe not a lot, maybe 10%, maybe 15%. It's better than nothing. And in fact, in some of the Chinese cities, I tell the leaders, I said, why don't you just pick one street, one short street of 1 kilometer in each key areas and upgrade it to show it to your people that good planning can make a difference to your environment. We don't have to be too ambitious. And I'm aware of the problem in India, but I feel that we should not allow that problem to almost become an excuse for not producing good plans.
May I invite the gentleman to ask his question? Then I would like to give the last question to the other side.
I'm Tan Shi Tiong, architect and planner. Aging in place has been a topic for the past couple of years. Even in the concept plan focus group, we spent so much time talking about it. If Dr. Liu, in the 20 years that he was in HTV, at that time we had that problem of aging in place as acute as today, what would be your solution in three areas? One, housing policy. Second, neighborhood planning. And three, architectural design. Thank you.
Actually, there was already some discussion about neighborhood planning, even in my time, because fortunately we did have a very active social welfare department, and I used to interact with them. Basically, there are a few key policies, key guidelines. One, don't concentrate all the old people together. You have to keep them in small communities, not even the size of a precinct, even smaller, just a small community within a precinct. Second, the aged people should be near the neighborhood centers, so they see a lot of activities, they interact with young people so that they don't age so quickly. And also, it's true, I mean, this is a proven scientifically, and also they can buy their daily goods within short walking distance. So actually, it is my wish that maybe, especially now the aging issue becomes a kind of irreversible trend, maybe we should look at that. And it's not so difficult to do because, as I mentioned in my talk, that I did do a study with my sociologists and the estate officers. We could use a void deck, take up a third of the void deck for the aged people, maybe to be near the children in the nearby blocks. And that probably will cater for a lot of aged people. And actually, it has one other advantage that I think few of you, especially if the men, would not know, and that is when you have a totally clear void deck, young girls coming home at night feel insecure. So in fact, we started introducing, take up a third of the ground floor to put in flats to give us a little bit of light, a little bit of life, a bit of assurance. So by putting that, using the one-third for the aged, one-third for the crèches in kindergartens or libraries and so on, I think we'll go a long way in catering for the need of the aged. And also, soon after I left HDB, I think my old colleagues introduced some kind of panic button and things like that in the one-room flat, again, catering for the aged. So I think a lot has been done for the aged, yeah.
Just a comment before I invite the other side to ask the last question. I think recently the building designs have been such that the void deck, as you knew it, has been reduced in size, and therefore they pose quite a bit of constraints on the location of facilities at the void deck. But anyway, this is for the HDB architects and planners to address. Can I have a last question from the other side?
Hi, this is Mieke de Schepper from Philips. A very interesting perspective on the developments of HDB in the different phases that HDB has been going through in the history of HDB. What would you see are the key challenges for HDB going forward and the new developments, especially with the plans of Singapore for expansion, the higher density of the city? These are challenges many cities have, but I think especially in Singapore, there's additional challenges. Where do you see the key challenges for HDB going forward?
Well, I think the larger population and the likely higher density are the reality that we have to face, because the alternative of sweeping the problem under the rug is not an option. We have to face that. But as I tried to demonstrate in my talk earlier, New York, Manhattan, I believe is twice the density as Singapore. And it was voted the most livable, Lee Kuan Yew's city of excellence last year. In other words, given very skillful and careful planning and forward planning and not doing an ad hoc response type of development, we can have a higher density and maybe using the chessboard concept also, but apply on a larger Singapore area, probably we can have a cake and eat it. And I think we have to, the sooner we face this issue, the sooner we convince the Singaporeans that to plan for a longer term, for a larger population, is necessary, it's good for everybody, the sooner we get going on this project, the better it is for Singapore.
Thank you very much, Thai Ker. And I think this is a very, very interesting, has been a very interesting session. I'm sure you still have many questions to ask him. Maybe you can still catch him afterwards. And I must congratulate and thank the CLC for organizing yet another very successful public lecture. And all the best to your work. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Liu Thai Ker and Dr. Aileen Wong, for sharing the insights with us. I would now like to invite Mr. Khoo Teng Chai, Executive Director of CLC, to present tokens of appreciation to our two guests. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. We have come to the end of the lecture.